My name is Jordan Kremer, and I've played the past three seasons professional hockey. Majority of that was spent in Alaska and the ECHL, and then a short stint in Abbotsford with the American Hockey League team there. And, you know, throughout my time playing pro, we've had a lot of bus travels and flights all over North America, and specifically on the bus. And Murray Cameron has done a great documentary on what it's like to be a pro and working your way through the system, and specifically taking his journey to Flin Flon and the history of Bobby Clark and what it's like to be a Flin Flon bomber and to always pursue your dreams and not give up. And it's going to be a good documentary on pursuing those dreams. So I look forward to seeing it.
Langley, B.C. to Flin Flon, Manitoba is 2,200 kilometers. I traveled there by bus to get ideas for a song about Bobby Clark. This documentary is about that trip. I spent 2 days in Flin Flon and then took the bus back. It took 6 days. You will hear voices throughout this project that are not mine, but are the voices of friends who I felt would be better suited for audio playback. I thank these people very much, and I hope you enjoy the documentary.
As I traveled throughout BC, past Chilliwack, Hope, Kamloops and Revelstoke and other places, I was awed by the British Columbia's beauty. I left Langley at 7:30 a.m., September 4, 2014, and got to Revelstoke in the evening. A transport truck had overturned on the highway, and we had a two-hour delay. While waiting, I met Larry. He was a 39-year-old from Vancouver going to Brantford, Ontario, to try out for a hockey team. He intended to sleep in a tent there. The tryout cost him $300. The accident was cleared, and we continued on our way.
We stopped in Banff, Alberta, sometime after 10 p.m. A lone boy was shivering in the cold. He was a Russian and had went to the Banff Hockey Academy. I told him to say hello to Gary Unger, who works there. I knew Gary from Global Scouting. He said Gary had dropped him off at 8 p.m. But because the bus was delayed, he had to wait 2 hours in the cold. He got on board and the trip continued. In my mind, I had a verse written, but I didn't write the words down, and I forgot them. A lesson learned.
On to the prairies we went. Miles and miles of cows and hay bales. The hay bales weighed over 1,200 pounds each. Two seats up from me, three French-speaking young men were talking. We passed by windmills, and I asked one of them to take a picture. His English was excellent. I told him I wrote a song about Alain Vigneault, the famous hockey coach. I said I wanted to send Alain the song, but I didn't know how to get in touch with him. He looked at me with surprise and said he was Alain's next-door neighbor in Quebec. I got his email, and the trip continued.
Friday, I was at Portage-la-Prairie. I had to wait for a connecting bus from Winnipeg that would take me on to Flin Flon. By this time, I had my first verse written down. The bus arrived, and it was practically empty. So I rushed to the back seat to try and get some sleep. The bus drivers were super friendly, and Greyhound is a well-run organization. Of course, getting sleep for more than an hour was practically impossible. As dawn approached, I took more pictures of the outskirts of Flin Flon. Lakes everywhere. Finally, I got the Flin Flon Terminal in Creighton, which is just outside Flin Flon. Saturday morning, 8 a.m.
I was picked up by Angela Simpson. Her son, Reed, played in the NHL. Angie had a few days off work, so she was able to show me around. And what a job she did. In the next part of this documentary, you'll listen to Bobby Clark's mother-in-law, Reed Simpson's grandma, the rink manager, local historian, Jerry Clark, and more.
Yeah, so I'm at the Flin Flon High School with the vice principal of the school. Can you imagine? Boy, this is... I'm so humbled.
He's a teacher too.
Vice principal impressed you.
Yeah. So anyway, what's your first name?
Patty.
Patty. So, and last name, Patty?
Krasinski.
That would be Russian.
Yeah. Well, my husband's Ukrainian. Yeah.
Everybody's Ukrainian. Yeah. Your part of Ukrainian.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Russian,
Ukrainian. Is that the reason why? Yeah. Maybe that's the reason why the hockey there's so many good hockey players. So, why do you think that the city of Flin Flon has produced so many NHL hockey players?
I think because people are pretty passionate about hockey around here, and people thoroughly enjoy it, and people thoroughly want to be involved with the Bomber organization and support our players and follow them through their careers. And kids that want to play hockey truly, truly love it.
Well, that's good. So we got information. Thank you, Mrs. McIntyre. I want to tell you a quick story before I go.
Okay.
When my nephew had finished university hockey, he wanted to try it for professional hockey. So I sent a letter to every NHL team, and his name was McIntyre. So the only reply I got back was from Bobby Clark. And I thought maybe he saw the name McIntyre and had a soft touch because he married to a McIntyre. But he was the only one. And my nephew went on and became a pro, even though that he didn't get any help from any of the NHL teams.
Right.
If you're going to make it, you're going to make it.
Right.
He
ended
up with the Winnipeg Jets organization. Well,
Monday morning.
This is started.
Okay, so my name is Daniel Dillon. I'm a teacher at Hapnaw Collegiate in Flin Flon. And the connection I think that I can make to this research is that the house that we purchased, which is at 100 Bomber Lake Road in Creighton, was the original lake where the Bombers used to play in Flin Flon. And the reason for that is because it's one of the fastest freezing lakes in the wintertime, because it's so shallow, it's only about 3 to 4 feet. So I'm assuming that's why they decided to go there. Now, I also heard that Bobby Clark, his grandmother lived in that house, and he was a youngster, and he played on that lake. Whether there's truth to that, I'm not sure, but you can research that. And beyond that, it's we're going to invite them out again this year, like I was saying earlier, to come out and play on the lake to kind of have some nostalgia of old times, because the younger kids, they try the coaches to ingrain some history into them as well, knowing the, you know, the context of these kids. They're playing on such a significant team and such a legacy that they kind of instill that historical component in the kids as well, so they know who they're playing for and where they came from. So we'll invite them out to the lake.
Now, when does it freeze over, and how long does it freeze over?
It should be frozen probably next week. We're now at July 15th. No. It should freeze probably mid-October, probably.
Sunday was a day of rest. In the morning, we went to the Mormon church in Flin Flon. In the afternoon, we walked around Beaver Creek, which is where many people in Flin Flon have cabins by lakes. I slept there for 2 nights and heard the peaceful sound of 2 loon birds. There's only 2 loons per lake, and they mate for life. Canoeing is very popular up there, and the town is becoming very cultural. I knew Monday would be super busy, so I got a good night's rest.
Monday morning, we went to the rink and interviewed 2 Flin Flon Bombers. I briefly talked with the coach and assistant coach. Afterward, I talked with the rink manager. His father made 2 chairs from hockey sticks. From there, we ate lunch and went to a graveyard where a teacher and historian, Jerry Clark, spoke with me.
On top of all that, the company was wise in its way of looking at trying to establish a stable population here. So you actually had the company going out and hiring people and bringing them in. This is apart from the guys that hopped the boxcars and came on their own. This is the people that the company went looking for, either because they had some extraordinary talent in music or entertainment or sports. So they would go into Eastern hockey leagues, Eastern Canadian hockey leagues, and they'd haul or hire guys to work at the company and play for the Flin Flon Bombers as early as the early 1930s. I don't know what the connection was. I don't know. There has to have been a person who was the go-between between the Detroit Red Wings organization and whoever was bringing people in here. Because Sid Abel and the Skinners and others played here for a year or two way back in the 30s.
Oh, okay.
How I came to Flin Flon.
Yeah. What made you come to Flin Flon?
I had to because my husband went.
Because he got a job in the mine. He got a job in the mine.
Yeah, he came, but like we had to go first to his brother. He stayed there. Like, he didn't stay long there because that wasn't for him. He's not a farmer, and he couldn't milk cows. They had 2 boys, one in grade 1, the other one in 3, and they milked cows. Mm-hmm. I couldn't milk a cow.
Yeah.
But you had to go looking for cow in the evening. They come home, the cows in the evening, but you had to look.
Monday night, I was back on the bus, and I knew I had to get some sleep Monday night, because I wouldn't Tuesday night. I got a couple of hours sleep. We had an hour wait in Winnipeg, played my guitar and harmonica for people. Soon the bus was on the highway and I was heading back to Langley. I had piles of information, but only one verse. I had a day and a half to get another verse done. Bobby, being a well-liked ordinary guy, played on my mind. Somewhere between Saskatchewan and Alberta, I worked out my next verse.
As the bus drove mile after mile on the prairie highways, I thought of the thousands of miles Bobby Clark must have driven, and from this I worked out my song's second verse. The miles were like blankets on his shivering back as he drove through the prairies learning skills that he lacked. The original words were different, but I changed them when I got back to Langley. The original words were, "The miles were like blankets on my shivering back. The farther I traveled, the less I looked back."
By the time I got to Langley Wednesday night at 10 p.m., I had spent 96 hours on buses and 2 days in Flin Flon. In summary, I want to thank everyone who has helped me complete this project, certainly everyone I mentioned in the documentary, and so many others who gave their support. An ankle in the Soviet Union. He stopped Bobby and the big band blues. He played some hockey in Flin Flon, Manitoba. Bobby Clark, this is your tune. His daddy was a miner and his mother were too. That's what the people say. He had a choice between hockey and mining. Paddy Janelle showed him the way. Like a blanket on his shivering back as he traveled through the prairies learning skills that he lacked. There was criticism, but what could he do? Family number one, hockey number two.